Okay, let's continue. So now let's understand how we can use if, elif, and else. So again, we are creating some function which will basically check the age of the person. And we are defining lambda statement to start the lambda function. And we are giving just one argument, which is age. And we are printing print kid if age is less than equal to 10. Print adolescence if age is in range 11 to 20. This is also wrong. I'm just explaining that this syntax is all doesn't work. We will see which syntax will work in the next statement. So you can see if we are defining multiple if statements. So as we know, elif doesn't work. So we try to use multiple if statements. So we are saying if age is less than equal to 10, then print adolescence. If age is less than in range 11 to 20, then I got confused. So print kid if age is less than equal to 10. Print adolescence if age is in range 11 to 20. Else print adult if age is in range this. Else print older. So anyways, this will not work. So I'm not going to spend much time on this. So you can see invalid syntax that we are getting. Now let's focus on the correct syntax that we will learn. So first of all, we are defining lambda and the age parameter is same. Now we are printing kid if age is less than equal to 10. Else, so now we know we can just use if and else. So the tweaking that you can do just with the else statement. So we are saying all the people who are less than equal to 10, for them just print kid. Else, in else it can be greater than 10 and it can be any age. So in the else statement we are putting a bracket, and within the brackets we are saying print adult if age is in range 11 to 51. So this is kind of elif functionality that we have defined using within else statement. So within else, we are also defining two logics. So first of all, print adult if age is in range 11 to 51, else print older. So what it will do, if the age is less than or equal to 10, it will print kid. If age is between 11 to 50, so as it exclude the last value, which is 51. So if the range is 11 to 50, it will print adult. Else, if the person is beyond 50, like 51 to any age, it will print older. So let's check the answer. So we are calling this age check multiple times by using different values, 78, 28, and just 8. So we should get the answer as 78, we will get the older. 28, we will get adult. And for 8, we will get the answer as kid. So yes, we are getting the correct output. We can also check for some other values like 45 and the borderline, which is 50. Okay. So we are getting the correct results, but if we change it to 51, then it should print the last value as older, which is correct answer. So this is how we can tweak our lambda statement to just use if else, but we can somehow include the functionality of elif as well. But now question comes, if you want to define multiple elif statements, how we can do that? So maybe if you're able to think this, you have to define multiple nested else statements. So let's see in the next example. So here we are writing lambda, the same thing is there. Print kid if age is less than or equal to 10. You should focus on this statement now. We are writing else and the bracket is started. We are saying print adult if age in range 11 to 51. Then after this, we are again writing else statement, because if the age is not beyond between this range 11 to 51, we are again defining else statement and we are again starting one more bracket and we are saying print older if age in range 60 to 91. Else print you are fit and you have to close two brackets now because we have used nested else statement within this lambda function. So this can be a little complex for some people, but if you understand it clearly, like by focusing on the statement and the syntax, maybe take some time and grasp the syntax that we are using and why we are using it. Then let me print the answer as well. So we will get the correct answer as per the values like kid, adult, older, and you are fit. So if the age goes beyond 90, which means 91 to any age, So it will print you are fit. So like 98 is printing the value as you are fit. Any confusion on this example? Because someone can ask you in the, if you're giving some interview, that how you can use elif within a lambda function, then you should know how to use that.
I just have to work on this actually to get familiarized with this.
Definitely. So yeah, there's no way to escape from it. You have to definitely practice a lot. Otherwise, you can get some errors.
It's basically rewriting the function, right? Like suppose first it will the system will check if it is less than 10. If it is not less than 10, it will check the next range. And if it is fitting the next range, it will consider that a person to be older. And again, it will go and check if it is also fits the next range.
Exactly.
Because so again, it and if that fits, then it will take the most recent thing.
Right. That is the answer. So if the no condition is meeting, like the condition that we have written, so finally it will print the last else statement that we have written here, which is you are fit.
Yes, correct. Yeah. So it will do the most recent thing. So it will overwrite the step by step.
Right. All right. So I think you got the concept. So let's move and let's see how we can. So this is important because this is actually used somewhere in your complex programs as well. And you, this can also be asked in the interviews. So let's see what is there. So now let's, to understand this example, you should be aware about the concepts of user-defined function as well as lambda function. Because here we are returning a lambda function from a user-defined function. So let's see how we can do that. So we are creating a function which is mult. This is a user-defined function because we are defining it using def keyword. And then it takes just one argument as num. And we are returning a lambda function by when we call this mult function, which is a user-defined function. And then by returning this lambda function, we are defining a logic that we have to multiply this number that we are taking in user-defined function and multiply by num1, which we are taking in lambda function. But now you can see that we are not storing this lambda function anywhere in the function definition. Likewise, we have seen multiple examples. If I go above, you can see we are saving this lambda statement inside this h check, then we are calling it. But here we are not saving in any of the variable, but simply we are returning it. But if you know the concept of return statement, we can store the value of return statement somewhere once we call that function. So let's understand. First of all, we are printing this mult function without, this is not a function call. This is just the printing of this function. So it will just say that this is a function by name of mult. In the next statement here, we are doing the function call of mult and passing on value for num as 9. So the function call is done. So what it will do, 9 will go to the function definition and it will return this lambda function by defining it as num1 colon num1 multiply by 9. So this is the function definition, sorry, lambda function definition that it will be returned to multiply. So as return statement is used, sorry, is there any question?
Yeah, num1 is not defined here, right?
Yes, num1 is not defined yet. So it will return the statement as lambda num1 colon num1 multiply by 9. So this will be returned. And now it will be returned and stored in the multiply function, and multiply will become as a lambda function now. So let me just complete and we will take the questions if there are any. So once we call this mult function, multiply will become as a lambda function, and then we are printing multiply, which is a lambda function, but we are not making its function call. We are just printing it. So it will print the print it like a function, and it will call it as lambda. And finally, we are calling this lambda function, which is multiply, and we are giving its value for the argument that it takes num1, and we are saying it is 5. So finally, what is the definition of lambda? So it was num1 colon num1 multiply by num, sorry, 9. So once we call this as 5. So what it will do, 5 multiplied by 9, and it will print out the answer as 45. Let me print it, and you can see the outputs. Now focus on the print statement that I've written. I'm printing these functions as well to explain how it is processing. So this is simple. It is just saying that this is a function mult, but focus on this statement, print multiply. So the lambda function that has been returned from this mult function here, it has been returned to multiply. And once we printed it, it is saying that this is also a function, which is a lambda function. It is not saying that it is multiply. It is saying that it is a lambda function, which is belong to the local of mult function. This is important to understand that if I check the above, if I scroll up, here you can see that once you printed the mult, which is also lambda function, it is simply saying function lambda. That's it. Then it is saying class function if I check the type. But here, if you're printing multiply function, which is lambda function, since it is being invoked by mult function, it is saying that it belongs to the locals of mult function, which is a user-defined function. So there is a thin line between the upper lambda functions and this function, because this function is dependent on the outer function, which is mult. And finally, once we are calling the lambda function, it has printed the value as 9 multiplied by 5 as 45. Now let me know if there are any questions on this. So is it clear or no questions or completely confused? Yeah.
So can we include multiple lambda functions within a function like this?
So you want to return multiple lambda functions from a mult function. Is it what you are saying?
Yeah. Can we include multiple lambda functions?
Yeah, we can.
I think you cannot, because return statement can only return, but you can do it something like this, return this, comma, if this was your question. So if we maybe, then what we can do instead of, so now returning, let's try this. So return statement is returning me two basically values. One is first lambda function, then comma, the second lambda function. So we also have to, if I just run this function, we should get an error. So we are not getting, but it's not giving us the correct results. So yes, it is saying tuple object is not callable. So what is happening here? If you understand the concept of return statement, if we are returning multiple values from using return statement, you also have to define multiple variables to which you have to save it. So this function, lambda function, first lambda function will be called from this mult function and will be returned to multiply. And we are saving the second function in maybe addition. And let's try it now. And maybe we can call the value for addition maybe 2. Sorry, this should be addition. Addition. So you can see that we have defined two lambda functions within the return statement. For the first function, we are doing the multiply by 5 multiply by 9 as 45, and then addition 2 plus 9 as 11. So I think this was your question.
Yeah. Okay.
Any other questions on this? Or any confusion? Okay, so let's proceed with the last example that I have for today. So in above code, so I just explained what is happening here. So last function is, we are checking if the given string or the argument value is a palindrome or not. If you like, just to give you a basic understanding what is a palindrome. So if this string is same, if you read it from the beginning or from the end, then that string is known as palindrome. So we are defining the logic to check the palindrome as lambda. Then the argument that we are defining, which is string. And then we are printing print yes palindrome if string colon colon minus one, which is basically used to reverse the string. This logic is there. If string colon colon minus one is equal to the original string, then print yes palindrome, else print it's not a palindrome. I hope logic is clear. Then we are calling this function palindrome twice to check the names. So first one is a palindrome, but second one is not. You can see that it is printing the correct output. And that is all for today. Let me know if there are any questions on this, or maybe any other concept that we have discussed till today. Okay, no questions from anyone? Okay, great. So just to give you a heads up for the next week, so we are going to learn a very important topic. We are very close to go to the advanced level of Python. So till now, we have discussed a lot of things, like from the very beginning, operators, different type of data types, then variables, variable declaration, various inbuilt functions like help, id, type, print, bin, etc. And then we talked about if-else conditions, for loop, break, continue, pass, then while loop. Then we also discussed about these user-defined functions. Then finally, we talked about lambda functions. In the next session, we are going to talk about methods that are there for each data type in Python. So in the previous session, we talked about split method, and also we have seen split method previously as well. So that is a method specifically for a string class. In the next session, we will talk about multiple methods that belongs to each class, like for numbers, like integers, float, complex, then strings, tuple, list, set, and dictionary. So we will talk about multiple methods. And then in the subsequent sessions, we will talk about list comprehensions, which is very powerful and very important. Again, list comprehension is also one-liner statement, but we will talk about it. And after that, we will go to advanced topics such as functions that I talked about a lot today, like map, reduce, and all. Then we will talk about decorators, generators, and then finally we will go into objects and classes. And that will be end for your Python raw course. And then we will go to libraries like NumPy, Pandas, and all. But please keep your excitement as it is right now. Otherwise, it will lose our purpose to attend these sessions.
Sure.
Yeah, definitely.
And definitely, if you complete the Python raw series, then you will be ready to work on some small projects that I am going to assign to you if you are interested. Then that way you will get confident on Python, and you will also build some application on your own. And I will start talking about libraries. What are libraries? How to build your own library, and maybe work on different libraries like NumPy, Pandas. And trust me, if you are going, if you are inclined towards machine learning and deep learning, you cannot work without NumPy and Pandas, specifically NumPy and Pandas as well, because all the data cleansing is done on Pandas. But NumPy is very important if you are moving towards deep learning. Deep learning, computer vision, and NLP cannot be done without NumPy, because that is the base for all the advanced libraries for deep learning, like TensorFlow, PyTorch, Keras. All the libraries are built on NumPy and some other libraries as well. So it's going to be very exciting in the further session. So let's meet next weekend and talk about some other concepts as well. So thanks guys for attending, and see you next week, and good night.
Thanks. Thank you so much.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye.